violence in Mexico was decreasing before 2006. And from 2006, homicide rates started to really increase very rapidly due to the fact that army operations were trying to mitigate drug cartels, and this exacerbated violence. The exacerbation of violence was such that by 2011, homicide rates more than doubled from around 9 to more than 22 homicides per 100,000 population. And that's when I also began interested on how to use demography as a discipline to study structural changes, in this case, increased violence. Demography is a discipline that studies populations. Demographers are interested in analyzing how people are having babies, how people are dying, whether different causes of death affect differently populations around the world, and also about migration. And demographers want to shed light on the dynamics and trends of all these three components that are the core of demography. Data is one of the most important things in demography. We can't analyze anything without having any type of data. So for example, death certificates, marriage certificates, and birth certificates. So once we have the data for our death counts and population estimates, we use one of the main models used in demography, which is called life tables. And life tables provide a snapshot of mortality in a population. So it really lets you analyze what are the mortality patterns by age, by sex, by state, for example, within Mexico, and then make results that are comparable. But nowadays, we're also going through a digital data revolution. So a lot of data now also comes from social media, comes from different types of surveys around the world. I've come to visit Ridhi Kashyap to talk about new types of data and how this can elucidate information about, for example, access to healthcare or women empowerment. Hi, Ridhi.
Hi.
How are you?
Yeah, I'm well, thanks.
I found your research very interesting. What is your research?
So I'm a demographer and I study populations, how long people live, whether they're healthy or not. I study issues linked to inequalities. For example, why do men and women have different outcomes in life? So essentially, I'm interested in different aspects that result in populations changing, and in particular, inequalities in populations. So these are gender inequalities and other types of social inequalities in populations.
It's really fascinating to see how can you use these new technologies to study social change. But how do you actually study it?
One of the big challenges for social scientists is that, unlike natural scientists or biologists, we can't just run an experiment in a lab. So one of the ways that we address this problem is we try and find natural experiments, things that are occurring in the world that create natural situations for why some people access something and some people don't. For example, when we look at sub-Saharan Africa, in our research where we were interested in the social impacts of mobile phones, we found that places where lightning strikes occur much more are places where mobile phone towers break down, and as a result, mobile connectivity is poorer. Now, using that information, we essentially had a natural experiment where individuals had no control over poorer connectivity. So making use of this natural experiment, we found that women who own mobile phones are better able to access health services, they know much more about contraception, they're much more likely to be able to make independent decisions about their health and their well-being, as well as their children's health.
It's quite a challenge to try to separate what I feel from what I do professionally. Of course, being Mexican and having grown up in this country where there's large inequalities and also a big problem with violence. But we try to separate that as much as possible and be as objective as possible when we interpret our results. I've come to visit Professor Jen Dowd to talk about how to get new sources of data, including biomarkers. Hi, Jen.
Hey, José Manuel.
How are you?
I'm doing well. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. I was wondering if you could tell me more about your research.
So I do research in a subfield called biodemography. We use lots of different biological data. It could be a drop of blood from a finger prick or saliva, or even a fecal sample to look at your gut microbiome. But we can get a lot of information about your biology and how your social experiences and context influence that biology. So we collect a lot of data maybe on your immune function, such as levels of inflammation in your body. And this tells us a lot about how your body is adapting to things that are happening to you every day. Social relationships, exposures like early life infections or stress, all of these things have signatures in your biology that we can track over time and then see how that contributes to accelerated aging and ultimately mortality.
Can you use this data to shed light, for example, on inequalities or how people experience different outcomes in population health within a country?
Yes, exactly. That's one of the things that brought me into this area of research, was trying to understand socioeconomic inequalities in health. We know that people with less income and less education live shorter and less healthy lives. And so we like to say, how is money getting under the skin and contributing to these different health outcomes? One of the areas that I've studied is how chronic stress over your whole lifetime, you know, people who have less income or less education often have just more chronic stressors in their life. It might come from their jobs and having, you know, higher risk of unemployment or not being able to pay their bills, getting evicted from their homes, for example. So there's a lot of ways in which chronic stress can influence your biology. Demography, again, I think is distinctive in using all these diverse data sources from satellites to cells.
I arrived to Oxford to hold the Newton International and Marie Curie Fellowships to continue working on my work on methodological development within demography. And these methods can be used not only to analyze violence like I have done in the past, but they can also be used on current problems, including the COVID-19 pandemic. So demography helps put us in perspective what our experiences are. And demography then can really shed light on these different dynamics, which then at the individual level can help us as a person to really, one, understand the other groups, to understand that we live in a world that is unequal, but at the same time to base our decisions as best as possible for the future.